Thanks for coming this evening. And thank you very much to Dewar for actually inviting me here. And what I want to talk a little bit about is propaganda. Not in the ways that it's usually talked about, which is deceitful, manipulative, and anti-democratic, but instead how it's absolutely essential, particularly in a democracy like our own, and how it might be done in such a way that actually supports rather than subverts democracy. So the ideas I'm going to be presenting here are ones that I'm working out for this book that Dewar just talked about. And as such, they're a bit fragmentary, okay? And what I really want to do is sort of sketch out a broad picture here. And then when I stop, we can actually fill in some of those blanks as well with some of the readings that you've been doing and some of your own knowledge, some of the knowledge that I might have, which I won't have time to present here. They're more illustrations and snapshots than a fully worked out thesis. But what I want to talk about, why I want to talk about this topic tonight is because while the history I'll be talking about is three quarters of a century old, the idea of creating change or selling hope, or this idea of how does one actually bring about some sort of transformation in society within a democracy seems remarkably relevant even today. So I'm going to start. Whoops, let's see. There we go. When you hear the word propaganda, this is often what you think about, okay? You think about spectacles of mind management like Triumph of the Will, which is Leni Riefenstahl's film of the 1934 Nazi Nuremberg rallies. Or perhaps you think something about like this, which are the patriotic posters of the Soviet Union under Stalin, where all the citizens seem to have muscular forearms and love their tractors, or in this case, their guns. But we also might think about the variant of economic propaganda. This is one of my favorite ads from the 1930s because it just lays bare what advertising is about. Here we are envying, and here we are being envied. And isn't that really what advertising's all about in any case? Propaganda, political propaganda, is something that we as democratic citizens of a republic are uneasy about. And there's good reason for this, because propaganda circumvents the mind. It speaks less to reason and more to the heart and gut, or sometimes lower. And it's about an emotional attachment to a politics as opposed to a cerebral attachment to politics. This is a famous picture of George W. Bush landing on the USS Abraham Lincoln in a full flight suit. This idea of a privileging of the politics of reason has a long history in our own ideas of politics. As in mainstream economics, classic democratic theory imagines citizens as rational and hopefully enlightened actors. And these rational actors, as the theory goes, discuss and debate and make choices based on their logical understanding of the issues. For example, here's a coffee house at the close of the 17th century. And this idea of the coffee house in Europe in the 16th and 17th century becomes this sort of vision of what democracy is supposed to be like, where people would get together, they'd read newspapers, they'd discuss issues, and then presumably take some sort of action based on those discussions. Here's a scene of the Second Continental Congress signing the Declaration of Independence in 1776, painted by Robert Edgar Pine also in 1776, and immediately turned into a very popular engraving by Edward Savage. Now, I want you to think about why it was painted in 1776, and I'll come back to that, and why it was reproduced as an easy to consume and relatively inexpensive engraving as well. Here's another scene. Here's another scene of our democracy in action. This is the signing of the Constitution painted by Thomas Rossiter between 1816 and 1870. Again, the date of when it was painted is actually really important, but I'll return to that. The idea of rational and reasoned debate is literally inscribed into the Constitution of the United States. Here's the First Amendment, which is make no law respecting establishment of religion, freedom of speech and press, and the right of people to peaceably assemble, which are all about the ideas of that in order for a democracy to function, we need to have full information. We need to discuss and be heard, and we need to act based on informed decision and have a freedom from state-supported dogma and superstition. And that this is something the Founding Fathers were very interested in, this ideal of democracy as a place of reason and rationality. The faith in reason, political reason, goes back even further than the Constitution. It's really part and parcel of our own philosophical ideals about what power and politics is. Here's Aristotle in his book, The Politics, where he says, other creatures live by nature only. Some live by habit to some extent. Man, however, lives by reason as well. He alone has reason. The idea is that the reason is that defining character of man and women which make a democracy possible. However, it's important to remember that Aristotle didn't only write about reason and politics. He also wrote a book on rhetoric and a book on a drama, the Poetics. Because what Aristotle understood was that people aren't only moved by reason, even though he talks about it in the Politics, but they were also moved by emotion. They are moved by persuasion. That is, the ability to capture and hold, the idea to move an audience, was just as important as the ability to speak to human beings' reason. Has anybody ever read Aristotle's Rhetoric? It's a great, if anybody's doing marketing, it is fantastic because it basically has the first audience research ever done, and it's about the Athenians. And it's all about what you need to say to the Athenians to get them to go along with anything. And his basically conclusion is, if you talk about ports, the Athenians add anything to the port and you're golden, okay? It's like, yeah, we should, go to war with the Trojans because it will protect our port. All right, let's go. So in any case, it's a great book. Unlike Plato, his teacher, who's dead set against rhetoric, Aristotle has a much more nuanced idea. He believed that even the truth needs rhetoric in order to make itself convincing. Remember what I asked you to think about a few slides ago, which are the dates of these. One in your top left is painted in 1776. This one's painted in 1860. Why do you think it would be important to create these great images of the signing of the Constitution in those periods in American history? Give it a guess. 1776, 1860.
1860, right before the Civil War.
You got it. 1776. Even easier.
Trying to get people to support independence.
Exactly. Okay. That these aren't just pictures of people signing the Constitution. They were mobilized images in order to create the idea of what this new American democracy was going to be like in 1776. And in 1860, the idea of keeping the Union together was absolutely essential, and this was a reminder to the American people of what our American Republic was built upon. Okay? So even while these celebrate this idea of reason and rationality, they're being mobilized for reasons of what I'm going to call propaganda, okay? Which is to convince people, not necessarily get them to think about the war and to think about the necessity of keeping the Republic together, but to feel it in their gut. One of my favorite of all political theorists, a fellow named Walter Lippmann, who was probably the most important public intellectual in the beginning of the 20th century. He was friends with every president from Teddy Roosevelt up until Lyndon B. Johnson. He was a newspaper editorialist who was syndicated in something like 300 to 400 newspapers across the country. When Walter Lippmann spoke, people listened. And Walter Lippmann probably is best known for his book, Public Opinion. But even before he wrote the book, Public Opinion, he wrote a book called Preface to Politics. And he had experience himself as the assistant to the mayor of Troy, New York. And what he realized is while he had been schooled in this idea of politics as reason, he understood that how things actually got done is through the idea of the dynamics, as he says, the dynamics, the will, the hopes, the needs in the visions of men, okay? In other words, it was fine to talk about democracy in theory, but when we want to talk about democracy in practice, you better figure out how to mobilize these ideas. And this is an idea that he took out later when he came up with the idea of manufacture of consent in his later book, Public Opinion, in 1923. But I think there's another option than Walter Lippmann's cynical manufacture of consent, or the idea of creating great spectacles to kind of create a fantasy which a German population or a Soviet population or sometimes even an American population will go along with. That is, you can appeal, you can understand the necessity of appealing to the will, the hopes, the needs, and the visions of people. Yet that doesn't mean that you need to stifle reason and rationality. In other words, I believe that you can have a practice of propaganda which is actually in tune with democracy as opposed to opposing it. And the beauty of this is, I think, that there's a case study that we can look at, okay? That this isn't just idle speculation, but actually there's a moment in history, which you are now very familiar with, in which this sort of experiment was tried from about 1932 to about 1941 during the New Deal, an experiment with what I call democratic persuasion or democratic propaganda was attempted. And what I want to talk about tonight is show you some examples, see how the New Deal administration did this sort of work and how I think they mobilized some of these passions and wills, yet at the same time appealed to the idea of an American democracy. Later we can talk about whether it worked or not. So as we all know, beginning in 1929 and all through the 1930s, this country faced a monumental crisis, the Great Depression. Here's a bank run in 1933. Here's a home being foreclosed in Iowa and a farm being foreclosed in Iowa. Here's millions being thrown out of work, out of their homes. This is flood victims in Louisville, Kentucky in 1937. Classic photo. Juxtaposition says it all. And the idea of bread lines were a common sight and an all too common necessity for far too many people. And this is an image by Dorothea Lange, who I'm going to return to. In 1932, American people elected FDR, partly because he promised, well, hope and change. Radical action had to be taken. But as importantly, because it was a democracy, the people of the United States had to be persuaded that radical action was necessary. The advantages of a dictatorship is that you don't really have to persuade many people to do much, okay? You have to persuade them not to revolt, okay, and overthrow you. But other than that, you can pretty much do what you want to do, okay? In a democracy, our leaders are actually beholden to the people, at least theoretically they are, okay? And they at least have to make appeals to public opinion and change the way people think in order to enact programs that will change the way that the country actually works. And FDR's task was formidable. It's hard to imagine how different this country was before the New Deal. The federal government was small, it didn't intervene in public life, and it had no capacity to do the sorts of things that the federal government actually did in the 1930s. And so what FDR had to do is he had to change the way people thought about government. That is, not an institution which is primarily about protecting people's liberty and freedom, but an institution that could actually be responsible and responsive to the public in determining economic and social life. This is a monumental change. We now have fights between the Republicans and the Democrats about the nuances of this, okay? How much government is too much government? How little government is too little government? But basically, we've all bought into the idea of FDR's government. That was not true in the 1920s, and this had to be created. A week after his inauguration, FDR took to the airways in what was the first of a number of fireside chats. Have you guys listened to fireside chats here?
We all have, right?
Just say yes. Well, just say no. Actually, it's much better. No. They say, no, I have no idea what these things are. Okay. So what FDR did, and he did it I think about 30 times in the course of his presidency, is he would go to the radio and address the American people directly. This was a pretty radical act at that time. Radio was a relatively new medium, and very importantly, radio was not controlled by conservative newspaper editors. He was having a hard time getting his ideas out there because most of the newspapers, newspaper editors, owners, I'm sorry, in the United States did not support FDR. So he had to find a new medium, and that new medium was radio. It also helped that all the radio stations depended on the FCC, which was under his control, in order to get relicensed. So they had a vested interest in actually putting him on the air. But I want us to listen just to the first couple of minutes of FDR's first ever speech about the banking crisis.
My friends, I want to talk for a few minutes with the people of the United States about banking. To talk with the comparatively few who understand the mechanics of banking, but more particularly with the overwhelming majority of you who use banks for the making of deposits and the drawing of checks. I want to tell you what has been done in the last few days and why it was done and what the next steps are going to be. I recognize that the many proclamations from state capitals and from Washington, the legislation, the treasury regulations, and so forth, couched for the most part in banking and legal terms, ought to be explained for the benefit of the average citizen. I owe this in particular because of the fortitude and the good temper with which everybody has accepted the inconvenience and the hardships of the banking holiday. And I know that when you understand what we in Washington have been about, I shall continue to have your cooperation as fully as I have had your sympathy and your help during the past week. First of all, let me state the simple fact that when you deposit money in a bank, the bank does not put the money into a safe deposit vault. It invests your money in many different forms of credit, in bonds, in commercial paper, in mortgages.
And then he goes on for 4 minutes explaining in detail how banks work. What's remarkable about this speech is its combination of persuasion and factuality and reason. It was scripted, as most of his fireside chats were, by scriptwriters, and in this case, also Robert Sherwood, who was a playwright. Okay, and they were created in order to present this image of Roosevelt, who was aristocrat, as a plain-talking everyman, okay? So in that way, it worked as propaganda. But what's amazing about his speeches is they actually just lay out facts. He doesn't actually rile people up with, you know, flamboyant rhetoric. What he does is very calmly and very gently say, this is what happened, this is why it happened, and this is what we are doing. And then he asks the audience to agree with him on these sorts of things. To the point of during World War I, he had this wonderful moment where he asked the Americans to take out a map of the world. He was explaining this arcane thing about the Lend-Lease program and where our ships were going to go on the North Atlantic in order to go to Europe to give weaponry or to lend-lease weaponry to the European powers, the Allied powers. And he asked the American public to put a map out on their table and follow along with him. And so what he does in these fireside chats is he really kind of reimagines what the relationship of a president to the public is going to be. Instead of being this sort of voice of authority on high, what Herbert Hoover was, a sort of an aloof president, or the sort of thumping demagogue, someone like Adolf Hitler or Mussolini overseas, he was going to be a teacher. And he was going to sort of, like we do in a classroom, bring the audience around by showing some text, asking you to think about it, and then taking people through the steps in order to make decisions for themselves. In marked contrast to the techniques practiced at the time by totalitarian regimes overseas, this form of persuasion did not encourage the adulation of a leader, but instead a discussion with a leader, okay? Even if it was only a one-way discussion, because that's the nature of the technology. It created an idea that one could actually talk to the president. And the president was flooded with letters. Every time he did a speech, tons of letters came back because people imagined that they were having a discussion with FDR. Oops. Now I want to show you another sort of cultural face of the New Deal. That of a young woman and her children photographed in California in 1936 by Dorothea Lange. So, have people seen these images before? They're famous, okay? She was working, Dorothea Lange at that time, was working for the Resettlement and later Farm Security Administrations, which was an agency set up in 1935 to relocate rural poor to better land and resettle them in experimental government cooperatives. Photographers working for the historical section of the RIFSA produced 77,000 photographs of everyday scenes of American and Americans. Their official job was to document the activities of the agency, okay? But under the direction of this guy named Roy Stryker, the photographer shot photos of conditions of American life and everyday Americans. In other words, photos that would help explain to the public why such an agency, and by extension, the New Deal, was needed. They put a human face on those helped by the programs and the policies of the New Deal. But they also had another striking effect, which is these photos literally re-envisioned America. They visually redefined who was an American and who deserved to be photographed after a decade of newspaper, magazine, and newsreel photos of celebrities and socialites, the sort of Paris Hiltons and Kim Kardashians of the 1920s. They redefined who had the right to be seen. And again, this was propaganda. Photographer shot with an eye for maximum emotional resonance. Dorothea Lange had started her career as a portrait photographer of the rich in San Francisco. But what they did is that they were also real factual pictures of real people in real places. That was, it was a propaganda in the service of reality. We often think of propaganda as that which covers over reality. The job of the FSA was to create these emotionally moving images like the ones we've just seen, but instead of covering over reality, trying to actually show reality as it was. What they did in the FSA is they tried to envision America not of just the wealthy, not of just celebrities, but an America of everyday people, and they did it remarkably well. At the same time, photographers, were roaming the states shooting pictures. A similar effort was used to sell the vision of America, the change of America that was underway in the medium of print. In the 1935, the Works Project Administration was created. And until its demise in 1934, the WPA created 8 million jobs for Americans. Among those employed by the WPA were hundreds of thousands of artists, painters, sculptors, directors, musicians, and writers. And under the auspices of the Federal Writers Project, thousands of writers, 7,535 at its peak, were hired to write guides to all 48 states, as well as territories like Alaska and Puerto Rico and cities like Washington, D.C. and New York. And here are the opening passages from the WPA guide to New York City. In the city, night workers, their footsteps sharp, irregular on the quiet streets, return home. A water wagon rolls by. Bands are still playing in half a dozen clubs. In the Upper East Side, in the Upper West Side, in the Gas House, in Hell's Kitchen, in Chelsea, in Greenwich Village, the faint and broken ringing of alarm clocks comes to the empty street. Another day, another dollar. Don't forget to tell the laundryman not to starch my shirts. Slowly, the air between the buildings fills with light. Again, what's amazing about these guides is that they're about everyday life. They're about alarm clocks going off. They're about the sounds that you hear in the city, people going to work. Now, you contrast that with, for example, New York City's last publicity campaign, which was called Just Ask the Locals, okay? And who were the locals we were supposed to ask? Actress Cynthia Nixon, Sean Combs, Mario Batali, Today's Show's Matt Lauer, and actor Kevin Bacon, okay? With the exception of Kevin Bacon, who we're all actually connected with, these people have little connection to the experience of everyday New York. Now Taylor Swift is the official ambassador. And you know, Taylor Swift is very talented, don't get me wrong, okay? Her New York and my New York are entirely different New Yorks, okay? This was an idea of a New York which actually belonged to everyday people. And these writings of the WPA serve to locate everyday citizens at the center of this country, not the periphery, not looking up to someone like Taylor Swift, but the type of people that actually you looked up to because you yourself were represented. Now, what's also interesting about these guides is they weren't just portraits of people in life. They had tons of facts, okay? I'm not gonna read this, you can read it for yourself. But it's fact, 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 fact. How big is New York? How wide is New York? How many boats are in New York? And so on and so forth. Endless, endless facts, okay? But what's interesting about these facts is they're sandwiched between these stories. And what I think's interesting about what's happening here is by sandwiching facts between stories, they're creating this idea of a fact which is given life insofar as it's part of the everyday life of people, okay? The idea of the fact, which was part of progressive America, the engineering of America. Herbert Hoover was known as the great engineer because he thought about America and he thought about the economy as something which you could tinker with, okay? Raise the interest tier, lower them there. We hear economists today talk about the economy in the same way. But what was great about these guides is they took the fact and connected it to the people, and they took the people and connected it to the fact. That is, what they tried to do was humanize facts. So any facts about the economy were also facts about people. But conversely, any discussion of people had to be based in real fact, okay? That is, they weren't just interested in creating some sort of phantasmagoria idea of people. They wanted a people rooted in reality. For these New Deal writers, facts were part of the narrative of life. The next series of slides are photos of murals painted in Coit Tower in San Francisco. Coit Tower was decorated in 1933 by artists working for the Public Works of Art Project, which was a forerunner to the WPA Federal One program, which created murals. These murals are, by their nature, fantasies, okay? They're not facts. They're not photographs of people and places as they are, not facts about the places where they live and work, but artists' visions of how Americans were and could be. So I want us to look at some of these images of America through artists' eyes. This is Victor Arnatoff, City Life.
Is that City Lights Books?
That's City Lights Books. No, no, it's City Lights, the Chaplin film. City Lights book is until 1950s.
Is that Chaplin?
Yeah.
Yeah, because I've seen the book like it.
It's Chaplin, and then City Lights books comes from...
Maybe.
Or from Chaplin, one of the two, but could have been from this as well. This is Maxine Albro, California, out of the city, into the fields. And this is Into the Factories. This is Ralph Stackpole, Industries of California. Again, we see the people and the people being represented. The forefronting of everyday citizens as creators of our past, present, and future. And these are very well-known murals, actually. But every single city, every single state had these murals painted. Some of them were beautifully done like these. Some were pretty crappy. Okay? But all of them reimagined either the history, the present, or the future of what America would be like, but putting everyday people actually in the center of those pictures. Okay? And this is in marked contrast to the other fantasies that were being peddled at the time, the fantasy of advertising, okay? In which the creator of the product and the process of its manufacture disappear. When you see an advertisement, you never see the factory, okay? For example, all the advertisements for Apple, right? You know, designed in California, Yeah, but they're made in a sweatshop in China, okay? But we don't see those pictures, right? Because that is part of the real history of commodities which disappears, okay? But it reappears here in these murals. Or fascism, in which the citizen or worker is only given presence and voice when they're created and amassed and organized by the state. Unlike these competing fantasies, the murals of the New Deal era portray a deeply democratic fantasy. It's a fantasy, no doubt, but it's a democratic fantasy. But I think the best propaganda for the New Deal was actually the material projects themselves. The more than 3 million unemployed young men put to work by the Civilian Conservation Corps between 1933 and 1942, which included 250,000 African Americans and 80,000 Native Americans, which was almost unheard of that time to have a government program actually assist these populations. And it was a very hard fight against the southern wing of the Democratic Party in order to enact these things. And as important was the physical evidence of what the CCC did. The parks they built, the land they reforested, the floods dammed, the forest fires put out, the roads built, all a material testimony to the role of the federal government in improving the quality of life in America. In other words, we think about propaganda as an image, okay, as a text or as a voice, which is what we've been talking about it so far. But it also is actually the material projects themselves. And there are many, many of these. The dams in power, agriculture, and industry of the Tennessee Valley Authority. The reclaiming land from floodplains, but also generating power to process fertilizer to make the soil more fertile. The idea of creating farmers and workers' housing. But my favorite example of what I would call material persuasion is the handcrafted Timberline Lodge, which is built atop of Mount Hood in 1937 by the Works Project Administration of Oregon. Who's here seen The Shining? That's this. Not the inside. The inside is shot in a grand hotel in Canada, but the outside, all the exterior shots, and the road up there are of the Timberline Lodge. And if anybody ever gets out to Oregon, if you go up to the Columbia River, go. And it's actually, what's great about it is you can still rent the rooms for relatively inexpensively. This is the lobby. This is the balcony over the lobby. These are the hand-carved banister knolls. In order to build the Timberline Lodge, local craftsmen from around Oregon were utilized, and non-skilled workmen were trained in handcraft traditions that had been replaced by mechanization. And these and other public works were built primarily as a stimulus to the economy. They needed to put people of Oregon to work, right? To provide jobs. But they were also worked as physical symbols of the New Deal, material evidence for the possibilities of public spending. Nowadays, for example, in the recent, 7 years ago, the stimulus package, you would get a tax rebate or a stimulus check in the mail. Look, I like getting one, believe me, okay? I like it when I get a tax rebate or my taxes get cut or what have you. Or I like it when I get a student loan or a Pell Grant. But these are things which are private. These are things which you open in the privacy of your own room. That is, they don't have a public character which says to the world, this is what the government can actually do, okay? They remain invisible. These were highly visible results of government programs. And in the case of some of the projects, like the Timberline Lodge, they were visible reminders of something more. Every hand-carved banister, all those handcraft details, really were also evidence of human hands. And you literally can see where tools go into it. And it says to anybody who's looking that actually humans created this, Americans created this, and this is our Timberline Lodge. And very importantly, it's a lodge for pleasure. Because part of this idea was that up until that point, only wealthy people could go to these lodges, these ski lodges. This was a ski lodge for everyday people. That it wasn't just about providing jobs for people, it was providing the good life for everyday people. These accomplishments were then publicized, okay? This is Woody Guthrie. Little known history of Woody Guthrie. He was actually commissioned in 1941 by the Bonneville Power Administration to go to the Columbia River, which runs right down below Timberline Lodge, and write songs in praise to the land, the river, and hydroelectric dams. So I'm going to actually play one of his songs in praise of hydroelectric dams.
Down along the river, just sitting on a rock, watching the boats in the Bonneville lock. Gate swings open, the barge sails in, the two-time whistles is gone again. Gasoline going up, wheat coming down. Well, I filled up my hat and brim, drunk a little taste. I thought about a river just going to waste. I thought about the dust, I thought about the sand, I thought about the people, I thought about the land. Folks running all around over creation, looking for a little place, something to do. Water comes splashing through the dam, trickling down across the land. Powerhouse sings, the generator whines, and down the hill comes a big power line. Electricity running all around, cheaper than rainwater. Lots of folks around the country, politicians and such, said the old Columbia wouldn't never amount to much. Fellers back east done a lot of squawking, and some of them are talking and some of them are balking. But with all their figures and all their books, them boys didn't know their Royal Chinooks. It's a good river. Just needs a couple of more dozen big power dams scattered up and down them, keeping folks busy. Well, I pulled out my pencil, I scribbled this song. Figured all them salmon just couldn't be wrong. Them salmon fish is pretty shrewd, you know. They got senators and politicians, too. Just about like a president. They run every 4 years. You just watch this river, though, pretty soon. Everybody's gonna be changing their tune. Big Grand Coulee on the Bonneville Dam. Has gonna need lots more of them scattered all over the land. Just a drop in the bucket. Need dams at Umatilla Rapids, Dalles, and Foster Creek, and Rocky Reach, and Arlington, and Sheeland, and 1,000 other factories. Turn out everything from fertilizer to atomic bedrooms and plastic trimmings, and everything ought to be plastic. Well, the folks need houses and stuff to eat, and the folks need the metals, and the folks need wheat. Folks need water and power dams, and folks need people, and the people need the land. This whole big Pacific Northwest up in here ought to be run, the way I see it, by electricity. And this here same electricity ought to jump and crackle and sparkle and jump, I think, around the whole world.
But what's great about it is it's Woody Guthrie. This land is your land. This land is my land. Singing about hydroelectric dams, okay? And it would be like getting Taylor Swift to, you know, write a song, for example, about college aid programs, okay? And it's great because it's kind of half serious, half joking, but it's deeply sort of, it's using popular culture in order to support a government program. Deeply imaginative. So the ideological task, and this is where I'm going to conclude, of the New Deal was immense. They not only had to convince the American public and the Congress that their solutions to the Depression were the correct ones, but they needed to change the very ways that Americans thought about government and citizenship. they needed to do what the contemporary French philosopher calls the redistribution of the sensible, that is, to really reorient how we understand reality. And I would argue that the administration did this, and it did it quite effectively by using art, culture, and even material accomplishments as publicity. What all these publicity efforts had in common was this idea, this assumption that form and content didn't need to be an either-or proposition, that human stories and objective facts might coexist, that aesthetic image and material reality might be complementary, and that publicity could be used to include and not distract the American people. New Deal publicity spoke to the emotions, but it also fed the mind. It was propaganda, but it was also propaganda in tune with democracy. So this experiment ended with the democratic art of persuasion ended with the entry into World War II. With the war came the return of all the old models of propaganda, images meant to inflame the emotions and quell the mind, messages that framed we the people only in terms of them the enemy. That is, the propaganda that appealed to our worst demons rather than our better angels. A return of the repressed. But I think in that moment, that brief moment from 1932 to 1941, actually a different idea of what propaganda could do was created. Now, what I didn't tell you is that there was no propaganda bureau of the New Deal. There was no individual actually creating a concerted effort of how to persuade the American people. That would come during World War II, just as it had been in World War I. What's fascinating, and I think helps explain the democratic element of New Deal propaganda, was all these different agencies doing all their own things. And they all had different voices, but still the same general project. And by creating all these different voices, all these different expressions, murals over here, songs over here, I didn't even show you the films or the theater, what we created is a multivocal idea of propaganda. Propaganda is usually thought of as one idea, the propagation of the faith. But in this case, when thinking about what would a propaganda for democracy look like, under the New Deal, it was realized, perhaps unconsciously, that the only way you can have democratic propaganda is to have a plurality of voices and a plurality of expressions. But still, an understanding that one needs to persuade the public to go along with the governmental initiatives if people are going to actually have change in America. I'll end it there, and we can open up for questions. Yes.
I would like to somewhat a little bit object to what you were saying about how the New Deal unconsciously created democratic propaganda about accepting all these voices. Because in Joseph M. I can't pronounce his name. In the Embodying the Depression, Male Bodies in the 1930s American Culture and Literature, mm-hmm. he talks about the contradictions in the proletariat idea, especially Michael Gold's idea about male bodies. Mm-hmm. And he talks about towards the end about Paul Cadmus, C-A-D-M.
Do you know who he was? Was he an artist?
Yeah, he was an artist. He was assigned to, have you heard of the mural The Fleet is In?
The Fleet is In, no, but I'll go check it out later.
He actually got fired because of painting that, because it showed sailors being friendly, engaging with prostitutes, probably a gay couple, and...
Sailors.
Yes, yeah, sailors, Navy men. And, actually, that was he got reprimanded for that. The second painting, he did the same exact thing, and then he got fired. But it seems to be like that there were some ideas that the New Deal did not want to present. It was not that democratic.
It depends. Did it censor? Oh, definitely. Okay, but I would say that there was no, and there's other examples. For example, a mural painter in Pittsburgh, hilarious, had painted some of the pictures of the bridges spanning, which local congressional critics thought somehow symbolized a hammer and sickle. And so therefore, you know, local governments bowed to pressure and they pulled it and they fired him as well. So there's plenty of instances throughout the New Deal that people were fired. But there was no centralized body that was doing any of that censorship. It was local bodies. Because particularly at that time, how the New Deal distributed money was through local offices. So for example, the Pennsylvania WPA would have been responsible for those murals in Pennsylvania. And if someone put pressure on them, they would actually then go and censor. That's not to say censorship didn't happen. It did happen. But it wasn't a centralized, self-conscious thought of idea of what is the proper idea, what is not the proper idea. It was very ragtag. People would often, what would happen is a local politician or a local civic group would object. And then, depending on the spine of the local person running the WPA chapter, they would either bow to it or not bow to it.
Well, he doesn't go much into that,
but
really.
I think that really actually serves, that fits your thesis. Even more powerfully, that local stakeholders of different types were involved in the decision making, that it wasn't a centralized bureaucracy or individual making these decisions. And so democratic doesn't necessarily mean clean and proper. It means that
actually dirty and messy.
Dirty and messy, right? So I think that example is a perfect example. And it is sort of the marvel that we've been talking about all semester about how messy this stuff is, yet how consistent on some level the sensibility is. And that's what I keep going back to and don't really have a handle on. And my question sort of related to this is, are you going to be looking at any specific sort of case studies where the messiness of decision making is played out on any of these different kinds of projects?
You know, I wasn't, but now I very well may. It's funny, the murals were the two things that are the most controversial were the murals and the theater project, okay? And I'm not looking at the theater project, but maybe I'll look at the murals. I would love it if you can give that, whatever that citation was, to Professor McLeod and give it to me, because I
think. Yeah.
Send it to sd47@nyu.edu. Yeah. Because I think that's actually a really good idea. It's something I hadn't thought of, but that's a great idea.
Because, you know, it's like Stryker running the FSA and stuff. Again, all these people get sent, or the WPA gets, all these people get sent out, and yet there is a rough commonality of sensibility. Yeah. And we've been discussing it on so many different layers all semester. I don't know how to add it up. And so propaganda is as good a term as any. I'm not sure. How did you come to that term?
Well,
Settle for that.
I only did it because it upsets people.
Yeah.
Because we have such a knee-jerk reaction. Propaganda, by the way, wasn't considered a bad word until after World War I. It was what you did, right? And still in other countries, propaganda is not considered a bad word. Its genesis is the propagation of the faith. You know, it only took on its negative connotations after World War I and then particularly after World War II. They, by the way, did not call it propaganda. I did some research in the FDR library in Hyde Park, and there's a great thing. If you go into the file cabinets, it has Democratic Party publicity, Republican propaganda. Those are the headings on the file cabinets, which pretty much just says it all. Propaganda is what they do. We do publicity. But I actually kind of want to reclaim the idea of saying that we can do propaganda differently. Because the problem I have is that if one doesn't reclaim it, one either does one of two things. One doesn't do persuasion at all. I actually think one of the huge failures of the Obama regime is when they are not campaigning for an election, they are terrible at propaganda. They just don't do it. And so they'll launch something like Obamacare and not convince anybody that it's a good idea before they launch it, okay? Or it becomes this purely technocratic, what will save money here, or this many people will get that. And there's really been no groundwork done for why the American people should accept this pretty radical change to how healthcare is delivered. So yeah, they either don't do it, or worse, when it is done, it's borrowed from the advertising industries. The techniques are borrowed from the advertising industries, or even worse, with George W. Bush landing on the USS Abraham Lincoln, literally borrowed from sort of fascist political playbooks, okay? And I don't think that's necessary. I actually think that there is models out there of how we can persuade people without bamboozling them. Yeah.
One of the core readings for our course has been the American Historical Review Forum in from 1992, Lawrence Levine on popular culture as the folklore of industrial society. And one of the critiques against him is that, you know, he wants to sort of go against the Frankfurt School emphasis on the production of culture and look at its reception.
Yeah.
And that's, you know, nowadays that's widely accepted, and that was, you know, an important contribution. But people like Jackson Lears, Robin Kelly, Natalie Zeman Davis all come back and say, yes, but, and Lears most particular, yes, but, as a good old Frankfurt School, and his thing is cultural hegemony in particular, you can't really understand culture unless you look at who's doing it and how. And I think it particularly, so that's historically is really important to look at who's doing it and how, right? How the FSA was put together or something like that. But contemporarily, right, it's who's doing it and how is really in the competition for the marketplace and for eyeballs and ears and screen time and all of that stuff is really, I think, where the story really needs to be.
Right, and particularly I think it needs to be done. I mean, the part of the problem is, particularly when you're a historian, it's very hard to find out about reception. And so part of what we do, I would hope that we could do both, right? And I think what Lawrence Levine was probably arguing, knowing who he was getting away from the idea that culture is something which is just transmitted and then not made sense of in varied ways, okay? But I do think that can move into a tendency of just the celebration of the reception and this idea that people can make sense of anything in whatever way they want, which actually takes away from that there's a source material by which people then make sense of, if that makes sense, okay? And so when people saw FSA photographs, for example, or they saw the WPA murals, they probably made sense of it in all sorts of ways. But the advantage of the producer is that they set the terms for what is being made sense of. That is, they define, we can never define how people make sense of the world, but we can define through production what people have to respond to. Yeah.
So maybe that goes back to your comment about form and content working together.
Tell me.
No,
no, but you're onto something. Play it out.
Well, because they can dictate the form.
Yeah.
Of the content.
Mm-hmm.
So
right.
But also, people react to form in different ways.
But I like what you're saying, which is it's not just the production of content, facts, for example, okay? Or an idea of that there are American people that need help and so on and so forth. But the form itself ends up, in part, not determining how people make sense of it, but actually shaping it in such a way. Now, there's a great, interesting example of this, which gets a little into the weeds, but I think it's kind of neat, which is Dorothy Lange's famous photographs. Let me go back for a second. Okay. That's probably the most famous, okay. One of the reasons why Dorothea Lange was one of the greatest photographers of and most popular photographers of FSA, but you could say the same about Walker Evans, although they fired him because he was a prima donna. But any of the great sort of, there was many great photographers, is that we see her as an individual, okay? We see this as a portrait. And again, Dorothea Lange was a great portraitist before she became an FSA photographer, okay? And so when we see this woman, we don't see her as an abstraction, right? We see her as a real woman, that look in her eyes of like, how am I gonna get through the day? What's gonna happen tomorrow? We can put ourselves in her position because we've all had those moments, we've all had those days. And that becomes the iconic photograph because the kids actually have turned their faces away, okay? If you see the whole reel, there's actually a teenage daughter off to the right. Right? She gets cut out completely, because it takes away from this photograph, or the Walker Evans photographs from Let Us Now Praise Famous Men, which are all these sort of family portraits, right? Where you actually can see these people presenting themselves. They might be in rags, but they're presenting themselves, and you see them as individuals. And why it works is because as a culture, we understand individuals and we understand the individual gaze, right? So it works immediately. The problem with Dorothea Lange and the FSA photographs is that it runs counter to the sort of social ethos of the New Deal, which is at one and the same time was about exalting the individual, but also saying we are an American people. And what this is about is not about the American people as much as it is the American person. And so the form which makes it immediately accessible is also the form which actually mitigates against some of the larger content of the programs of the New Deal. At least that's my theory. I haven't worked it out that much, but it just struck me. Linda Gordon, who's a colleague of mine, wrote a fantastic biography of Dorothea Lange, where she talks about her as a portraitist and the importance of her portraiture. And so I had talked to her about this at one time.
I think it's fascinating. It doesn't all work, right? It doesn't all work as propaganda because there's no centralized driver of it. You don't mention the aesthetic really a whole lot, but one of the things that always, I keep coming back to it, is a lot of this stuff is shockingly good.
Yes.
And I know there's crap too, but that opening to the guide to New York City, you're not going to put that book down after reading that paragraph, right? Do you have an explanation for why that is?
It depended on agency to agency, okay? People like Roy Stryker and the people that were running the WPA mural project were hiring the best muralists and hiring the best photographers they could get a hold of. They hired Walker Evans, you know, who was just, even at that moment, was a great photographer. Everybody knew he was one of the greatest American photographers, and they hired him. The WPA, outside of the mural project, had a much bigger problem, which is they had to create work. So you get the FSA, they're not a work creation program. They're basically hiring the best artists they can find to do publicity for them, okay? The filmmaking that comes out of the FSA is very much the same thing. The theater project hires one of the best directors, avant-garde directors around, I forget what her name is, but she was at Bard College. The WPA writing project is difficult because they have to just hire who's ever there. So the New York one is great. The Nebraska one is terrible, right? Because there's just not that many great writers in Nebraska. And if you read any sort of histories about the writers' project, it's all about the local editors complaining that they have these essential drunks coming in, you know, who can't write a lick, but somehow when they were filling out the WPA thing, wrote down, "I'm a writer." You know, and now they're stuck with these writers. And so a lot of it was about sidelining the people that were terrible in order to get to the people that were great. Yeah.
You mentioned towards the end there that the idea of democratic propaganda being successful because it branched out in so many different directions.
Yeah.
The thing that came to my mind was the fact that do you think that the reason why it branched out in so many directions, being that there wasn't a centralized agency that was handling this, was to reach all different types of socioeconomic backgrounds and people?
I would say that might have been the result. Not so much socioeconomic backgrounds, because it really is, FDR is universally hated by the rich. And you know, his famous 1936 speech in Madison Square Garden, as he says, "I welcome the hatred of the bankers," and so on and so forth. But what you are right about is it spreads out demographically in terms of rural and urban, black, white, male, female, Midwestern, Eastern Seaboard, and so on and so forth, and really and middle class and working class as well. The problem is that there was nobody making that conscious decision. It's almost just accidental. I mean, I'm sure that you've read this, is that the WPA, I mean, the New Deal is just a mess, right? And it's just, there's this one great anecdote, which I think is in one of the books that you've assigned, where he has Tugwell, Roy Tugwell, who's his pretty radical agricultural minister, who Roy Stryker was his research assistant when he was at Columbia and worked with him. And then he has, my brain is terrible, this is why I'm not a great historian, who is the first Treasury Secretary under the New Deal? He's a banker. Okay, so he's a very conservative banker, and they can't agree on something. And so FDR says, go into another room and come up with something that works for both of you, and don't come out until you're done, okay? Which is crazy, okay? It's absolutely bonkers, but that's how FDR understood.
Morgenthau,
yeah, exactly. That's how he understood how to run a country, which is a really interesting way. Can you imagine, for example, Republicans and Democrats just saying, look, we don't really care if you disagree. You go into a room and you figure it out, okay? Which would be wonderful, because another way to do it would be a dictator. Adolf Hitler said, essentially, this democracy cannot function. All these people do is bicker. I am going to set the path for the world, for the country. But FDR had a completely different strategy, which is there was policies which the FSA were running, which were being contradicted by what the Treasury Department was doing, which were being contradicted by the NRA, the National Recovery Act, that all of these things are happening. And so in some ways, the charitable way to look at it is that's how a democracy works. It's messy. The uncharitable way to look at it was like it was a rolling train wreck, and they were so glad to get into World War II where they could actually have a command economy from the top down.
Do you think there were any missed opportunities for propaganda?
That's a great question. I think the biggest missed opportunity for propaganda it wasn't missed consciously. They knew they were missing it, but there wasn't much that could be done, which they did not. Most of the propaganda was targeted towards white people. And why that was that we now think of conservatives as Republicans, liberals as Democrats. That's not how things actually worked in the 1920s and the 1930s, actually from the turn of the century up. There was incredibly progressive Republicans, like the Wisconsin Republicans, Teddy Roosevelt, for example, and there was incredibly conservative Democrats, which were the Southern wing, and they were segregationists. And anything that smacked of racial desegregation, they slapped down immediately. And so FDR made huge compromises regarding, you know, fair housing, for example, public programs. As I said, it was amazing that the CCC employed so many African Americans and Native Americans. And I'm not sure how he did it, actually, but he was able to do it. And I think that was a real missed moment. But again, not one he could have done any otherwise. If you go to look at the files, and I was told by this by someone who went down and looked at the Library of Congress files of the FSA's photographs, actually there's an immense amount of photographs of non-white Americans, but you almost never see them published because that wasn't the face of America. America could be, you know, this woman, right? But what's not known about this woman is she's Native American, okay? But she appears as white. And that's why she was okay, because she became a sympathetic face for the American people.
That's where I think some of the behind the scenes stuff is really, I mean, and this stuff has been really looked at a lot. You know, Alan Trachtenberg has a nice people, Levine has a nice piece. When we remember the first week we talked about this picture, and I was like, can't we get past this picture? You know, but no, if you have a half hour to teach the Great Depression to your sixth graders, your ninth graders, you're going to use this. And I haven't come up with a better one.
Yeah.
And I think you captured the idea. First of all, people like it because it's a great photograph and it humanizes her. And it may not fully demonstrate the propaganda effect of the New Deal, but it certainly demonstrates the suffering of the Great Depression.
Yeah.
And it's just, it's impossible to find something better to, but the way to find something better and something different, this is what social historians do, is you find the other stuff that's there, right? And that, when you have more than a half hour, when you have a semester, you start filling in. And again, you know, most history was just the history of great men until people had started. I was thinking the other day about the first woman who did a history of, the first historian who did a history of women in the Revolutionary War was basically, in that era, it was like, you can't do that by her advisor. There's no sources, right? And there's a whole field of women's history from that era based on tons and tons of sources, right? So finding those sources, that might be a great case to look at how propaganda was created.
Yeah, I've got a good one if anybody wants a research project. Okay,
yes,
here's the research project. The photos of the FSA RA have been done 1,000 times, millions of times, okay?
And they're
all available on the web. You can do them, but they've been done. And they've been done by some of the best historians in the business, okay? What hasn't been done are the murals. And what's amazing is that the murals that we see, these ones like this, okay, which are essentially North American versions of Mexican murals, okay, by Diego Rivera, Orozco, and the great muralists of Mexico. These are the ones that we see over and over and over and over again. But if you, and now you can actually search on the web, it's very incomplete, but there are websites which actually go state by state and show the murals which are in post offices and schools from around the country. And what's fascinating about this is these are in San Francisco. Other great ones are in New York. There's a great one in a school in the Bronx, and where my kid goes to school, which is a public school on 18th Street on the west side. The auditorium is beautifully done up, and the library is beautifully done up because New York painters were there, okay? But if you look at the paintings in Vermont, or the ones in South Carolina, or the ones in Nevada, you start to get a sense that there's other types of imagery out there. They're much more realistic, they're not being influenced by the Mexican muralists, and they're often of, like, the colonial revolution. They're of things like the Westward Wagons. They're very much about using American history as a way to actually give credence to the New Deal. These are the radical communists who are creating these, right? But a lot of those murals are really created by people who are seeing the New Deal, and I wish we could have played the Woody Guthrie piece, because he's trying to tell the American story as this sort of unbroken chain from, you know, the revolution all the way to hydroelectric dams. But there's a great research project in looking at not the greatest of the murals, but actually the mediocre murals, because there was a lot more of them than the great ones. And I think they say as much about the mural movement. And I've read about 5 or 6 books on the mural. Nobody talks about them. Nobody talks about them because they're not aesthetically interesting. From a historian standpoint, they're incredibly interesting. Yeah.
Talked a little bit about maybe missed opportunities for propaganda. Do you have any thoughts as to what might have been the most successful method of propaganda?
That's a really great question. I'm going to answer it two ways. I'm going to say, off the top of my head, I don't even have to say off the top of my head. I'll just state it. That. The fireside chats were incredibly successful. They really, really changed the relationship. I mean, FDR was one of the most beloved presidents of all time because people really felt they had a relationship to him. He was able to change the federal government and actually bring Americans into a war and almost out of it when there was incredible isolationist feeling in the United States at that time. And part of it was people just trusted FDR. They really, really trusted him. And that was, it was incredibly successful because they could imagine him as in their living rooms. Think about what a radio does. Now we're so used to a TV, like in our living room, or a computer in a living room. But think about the radicalism of that when you went to see an image or something of that nature, or heard something, you went out and you were amongst an anonymous crowd, and then you saw something. The radio actually brought the President of the United States into your living room. And that creation of a sense of intimacy was incredibly effective. So what? And then there's a second part to your question, which is one I'm fascinated by. If you get a chance, go on YouTube and watch a film called The River, which is by,
Farrell Lorenz.
Per Lorentz, exactly, who was a documentary filmmaker who did a couple of films for the FSA, The River, the Plow That Broke the Plains, and so on and so forth. Okay, and they were huge critical successes at the time. I went up and saw his scrapbooks at the FDR Library, and they're filled with praise from the New York Times, and he gets a Pulitzer Prize for the screenplay. And tell me what you think when you watch it, because I think it really sucks. It is just unbearable, okay? It is unwatchable.
Like Teletubbies.
It is like the Teletubbies. It's just like, and the river flows down from the Alleghenies, down from the, you know, and it's just like, oh, if I hear that again, I'm going to kill myself, okay? And what makes me think about is like, why that was successful at the time, but it doesn't hold up at all. Where if you go to Dorothy Lange, this stuff still holds up, you know? And what is it about an aesthetic which lasts throughout the time? So, for example, my book, what I'm going to do, or at least what I'm thinking about doing, is talking about The River, but then talk about another film that also discussed the Depression, which is Preston Sturges' Sullivan's Travels, which is hilarious. Go watch it tonight. And you'll just say, that's really good, okay? Basically the same time, it's about the Depression. There's even a great scene in the beginning where they're creating a film. He's creating a political film called Oh Brother, Where Art Thou? Which of course becomes the title of the Coen Brothers film, which is about labor and capital struggling on top of a train. And it's just ridiculous, right? And then it's a story of a guy who a film director who wants to make proletariat films, doesn't know how the proletariat lives, and goes off on the road and figures it out, okay? Partly getting amnesia and so on. I won't ruin the rest of it for you. But what's amazing about that film is it holds up, okay? And so that makes me think about, that has made me think about, like, what aesthetics actually still have play in the present day and what just don't work at all. So that's kind of a complicated answer to your nice direct question.
Remember the first part of your answer, because there was something there, but no, Sullivan's Travels is I prefer The Lady Eve, which is another Preston Sturges movie, but he's my absolute favorite. And Sullivan's Travels is really the sort of documentary, and Dickstein talks about it, but we never really got into it in terms of really going through it, and because it's 1940 or 41, so it's already very much sort of pulling in all the different tropes of the style. I was talking about, I was watching a Barbara Stanwyck movie with all the same character actors, and her father is Charles Coburn, the actor, and he's the industrialist, and she falls in love with Van Heflin, who's the communist. But the movie itself, I think, is from 46, and it's so played out. It doesn't hold up, but that's the staple of a 30s movie, right? The heiress meets the bum, or things like that. But the what was the other part of the first part you mentioned?
We talked about the fireside chats and how they're probably the most effective part of propaganda.
Yeah, and oh, I know, I was watching a Harold Lloyd where he's, but it's a talkie with Harold Lloyd, who's the great silent star. Yeah, from like 34, I think, maybe a little bit later actually. But he's raised by missionaries in China, so he comes back to the U.S. and he's missed the whole birth of modernity, so that's where the comedy comes in. So he hears the voice coming from a car radio, and he's just starting, where is that coming from? He doesn't understand the concept at all, which is funny. And then the plot is that he gets pulled into the political machine and is put up to run for office because he's an innocent that they're going to be able to take advantage of. But of course, he quickly catches on and says, no, you're not. And that's as far as I got on that one. I watch it, you know, we talk a lot about the aesthetics because I watch a lot of that stuff at Turner Classics sort of in the background, and some of them grab me and say, you must pay attention, and some of them don't. And there's plenty that do, but I've seen most of them. So now I'm really making my way through all the ones that are so generic, and they still have a pleasure to them, but, you know, the Hollywood factories are churning them out as well by a formula.
Yeah, but what's interesting about The River is it's not... It doesn't work because we've seen it 1,000 times. It doesn't work because it's an aesthetic which never caught on. And you could almost imagine in a parallel universe, it could have caught on, and we would be loving those films.
Over in the Soviet Union.
Exactly.
Right? I mean, it literally did. Yeah. That's
Although,
what it reads like.
By the 1930s, the Soviet propaganda films are things like Circus, which are kind of takes on Hollywood films, but with big forearms and tractors. Yeah.
Yeah, and there's some great Soviet films.
Oh, the early Soviet films, but they don't catch on either. That is that I think something about those films is that they demand that you think. I mean, Eisenstein films, for example, or Man with a Movie Camera, Vertos.
So you mentioned early in your talk that, you know, the dictator doesn't have to persuade.
Yeah.
But of course, that's not true at all, right? And
yeah.
Since you don't have much to do in this book, I think you should compare to a detailed study of Nazi Germany and the Soviet Union in the 30s too.
Well, I'm going to have to because, well, the other players in the room are fascism and advertising. Because they're the different models. I think they do have to.
That's the Frankfurt School. Yeah. That's what they're or advertising slash Hollywood.
Right. Exactly. And what I want to point out is that there is this third player in the room, which doesn't last very long, but actually suggests that there's a very different model.
So are we persuaded by this? This is my question by his thesis, right? That there is this different model. If this somehow works, it works as propaganda more or less, and it upholds democracy more or less.
I think the word propaganda kind of threw me a bit, just because we do have those preconceived notions that it's going to be some intentional message that's broadcast to the masses and has this very important centralized message. But then we're looking at this. But I like how you talked about the idea that a democratized propaganda needed to be, hit all different facets in all different directions, and I definitely buy into that. I think it that makes a lot of sense.
And in different voices, I think that's kind of, and in different media, and it's just, that's what I find fascinating, is that the FSA stuff is about really the world of impoverishment, where the WPA murals is the sort of this ideal of what could become. And so they hit it at all different places. And you could imagine perhaps some genius propagandist sitting down and said, we're going to do it this way there and this way there. But I'm not sure they ever could.
Something I kind of got into doing a little bit of audience research in the 1930s, radio research, was the idea that that's why I mentioned socioeconomic status, because there was the idea that people that were above the middle class, let's say, really didn't spend much time listening to the radio as opposed to lower class, because they were busy going to the art galleries. They were busy seeing different types of culture. And what came to my mind was the fact that maybe the reason you needed to spread out this message and do it in that way was because not everyone is going to listen to one medium. Not everyone's going to go to a theater or listen to the radio. But if you do, if you spread out, you're going to make sure that the message is seen throughout and be more consistent.
That makes a lot of sense, yeah. And remember, these photographs weren't seen as photographs in art galleries. They were illustrations that FSA would give out to magazines. They would stage sort of shows like in World's Fairs or in educational, the films would be seen in high schools and stuff like that. So, but I like what you're saying, which is it wouldn't have worked if it was just a theater program. Because that's, or if these were only seen in art galleries, because that's just the wealthy who are going to see them. Yeah.
Yeah. So just like in the past few years, education has espoused this multiple intelligences kind of thing. Hmm. That's what this reminds me of. People relate in the ways that they relate to everything, whether it's auditory, visual, or kinesthetic.
Yeah.
And so that's... that's where form comes in.
Yeah, I like that.
The other point was, if this is indeed a new model, mm-hmm. and you have convinced me that it is, I think you should come up with another name.
Yeah.
Other than propaganda.
The name of the book is Democratic Persuasion. It's not propaganda, okay? And I've been convinced by my publisher, by grant agencies, don't call propaganda, but I'm still holding on. And I figured I was going to get free reign here.
Yeah, sure.
But you're probably right. It'll probably be going to be Democratic person because no one likes it except for me.
Yeah, and it's clearly partly from perversity, right?
You partly like being an ex-punk rocker.
Right, right. Yeah,
that's really what it's about.
Yeah, but it's worth trying on to see because it also, what it does, it redistributes the what's sensible in terms of the definition, right? Because we like to think propaganda is what they do, not what we do, right? And that's why, but I do think if you're going to call something propaganda, I think the key element is looking at where it comes from and who puts it together and how they distribute it. And that is, there's a relationship of power to the production of a cultural item that determines whether it's propaganda or not. Yeah. You could say that the framing of this is propagandistic, I suppose, right? As apart from how it was created. Yeah. So there is that. There is these sort of aesthetic, but there is also propaganda in the real world is about how it's funded, how it's produced. Right. And I do think there's stories to be told and to be discovered in terms of how the administration, the FDR administration, was conceptualizing this, discussing it amongst themselves and with outside sources. And even though they were documenting, they were well aware, as you know, Stryker, for example, but all of them were well aware that they have an agenda.
Yeah,
and I think maybe partly why you like it and why you're persuaded is, you know, this course has made me I already was, but more than ever, a New Deal liberal, right? I'm not an anarchist, I'm not a libertarian, I'm not a fascist, I'm not a commie, you know, more and more, like, and I've always been, but, like, I agree that this works, right? This worked for this brief moment. Now, maybe it works because we just keep looking, not looking at the stuff we can't look at, which is the African Americans who are excluded, right? The Southern Democrats who blocked everything. Like, so we there's so much to look at that we're blinded by what we're missing still.
Right.
That in fact this doesn't persuade. There's still a hardcore capitalist class that doesn't disappear and that doesn't stop its assault, right? And the moment they can, if not during the war, certainly by 48 with Taft-Hartley, right? That they can start clawing back. And one could argue, you know, has been doing that ever since.
Right, and actually the other thing that just passed after the war is outlawing internal publicity and propaganda. That is that we can create external propaganda through the CIA, USAID, and so on and so forth. We can't create internal propaganda. And I actually have to do some research about why that was passed. My hunch is that it was passed partly in the fear of what propaganda had created with fascism. But I'm wondering if there's also another story, which is an understanding that this stuff was incredibly effective.
Yeah, and you want our man Obama to be good at this, and then you see Bush, you know, who's not our man, being very good at it. Right?
Well, except that I don't think he was good at it. Yeah. I actually think that the unfortunate thing, regardless of one's political standpoint, is that I think that Bush actually created the ham-fisted approach, which then fell apart. He couldn't use any of the images that were carefully created around things like 9/11, landing on the USS Abraham Lincoln, 2 or 3 years later, because the truth of Mission Accomplished had already come out, okay? And so that's the old style propaganda, which is you cover fantasy, or cover reality with a fantasy, and it doesn't work very long. It goes back to the US, you know, the real Abraham Lincoln. You can fool some of the people some of the time, but not all the people all the time.
Faith is that reality wins out, right?
What?
And you know, that staging, I don't know, this is maybe many of you don't remember this, but it's a really iconic moment. And what's important, you know, the whole backstory is fascinating in that this was actually off the coast of San Diego, and they actually turned the aircraft carrier around for him to land on so that the sun would be in the right angle for the shot.
And so he couldn't see the land.
And he supposedly flies this in. My people, I read, call him Commander Codpiece for that. C-plus Augustus is another
one. Well, and he also, the main thing is he dodged the draft in Vietnam. And he recreated himself.
Doing that as well. Didn't go in for his drug test, by the way, for that year. Yeah. But the other part is it did work. See, I would disagree. I remember seeing Chris Matthews and others. Was he MSNBC or And he said that, a thrill ran down my leg, I think is almost the exact quote. And
it was the cod piece,
gendered
obviously.
Stuff that's very yeah. interesting about this. And people drooled yeah. over this. And maybe men more than women, right? Men who saw this as their ideal, right? We had a president not too long before who got trained as a Hollywood actor in order to, ultimately assume the role of president. Mm-hmm. So I would disagree. I'd say this stuff does work. Doesn't work forever, right? And I think in Bush's case, it was Katrina, which the emperor's clothes disappeared with that. Yeah. But it worked for fairly long.
No, it did. And I would say, and this has more to do with my other books, is we always have to ask, is it ethical? That is, let's not just say, does it work, but does it work according to the principles which we hold dear, such as we don't try to fool people. We don't move aircraft carriers. We don't pretend you're a warrior when you dodge combat in Vietnam. And that's sort of creating a nation which is based upon lies. So even if we could do it, we don't do it. But I think equally bad is Obama, who has that sort of liberal technocratic idea, which is, well, everybody I go to school with thinks this is a good idea. And so obviously people are going to think it's a good idea, right? I'm smarter than everybody else. And I think that's the beauty of FDR is he just, in the New Deal, is they didn't come in with the approach of we know better than other people. They came in with the approach of we have to explain to other people what we're going to do, partially because they had to do a massive transformation of society, partially because they were scared of communists, partially because, they really believed in sort of the educational project, but they did it. And I think that, both liberals and conservatives could really learn from that. This fellow right here. Yeah.
I think the difference between Bush on the aircraft carrier and things like this is the whole staging and everything. It was, when he did it, it was kind of a bold face act of propaganda. Whereas, the one reading we did, Stryker was telling them to just go out and take random shots of things. So this picture was almost accidental. There was no, besides the framing and cutting out the one daughter.
It literally was. She was just driving by, saw it, got out of her car, shot the pictures,
So I think this is, on the one hand, it is propaganda in the basis sense of appealing to the emotions and trying to achieve something with the piece of art. But on the other hand, it's like you were saying, it's a different form of propaganda where
it's based in reality.
Yeah, it's trying to convince people of a in a democratic nation, like everything you were saying before, it's not somebody trying to convince the people that they're right and you just have to go along with it. It's a softer approach.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Well, I want to go back to this idea of performing reality versus covering over reality, okay? There's this idea, kind of an Enlightenment idea, that reality is self-evident, okay? That if things are real, then all good people will come to that realization and agree, right? What I think was brilliant about the New Deal, which also, by the way, was brilliant about the Civil Rights Movement, was this idea of understanding that one had to perform reality in order for it actually to be understood as real. They didn't make stuff up, but they that classic picture of Rosa Parks, right? Rosa Parks sitting down on the bus. Now, you all, because you're in history, know that she was actually a trained activist, and that was a very self-conscious thing. But what I didn't know is that picture, okay? And if you think about it, it makes a lot of sense, okay? That iconic picture, that wasn't taken any time during that moment. It was taken a year later. And that white guy behind her, he's not like some Southern bigot. He's an AP reporter. They just needed a good contract. So they put these white reporters there. They're like, go sit there, scowl a little bit. Okay, there you go. Okay, and it's, that is, they orchestrated that, but it was also real. That is, the reality is that she did get arrested. The reality was she sat down on a bus and, she couldn't sit down in a bus. Same thing when the 1963 campaign to desegregate Birmingham, Alabama. They planned that because they knew Bull Connor was going to overreact. They had done the same demonstration in Georgia, Augusta, Georgia, I think Augusta.
Albany.
Albany, Georgia, the year before. Mm-hmm. And it failed because the police chief was really smart. He arrested everybody, put them in jails all over the region, so they couldn't talk to one another, and no reporters could actually get to them. And then it was very civilized about the whole thing. And all the reporters went home, and he let people out. And they picked Birmingham because they knew that he would overreact, and they would get those images, which they needed in order to sway the American public and, very importantly, the world public. Does that mean that those atrocities did not happen? No, they did happen, right? They happened all the time, but they happened when no cameras were there. They happened at night. They happened in the black neighborhoods. This was about bringing it into light. Anyway, you had your hand up before.
Something that came to mind was the idea of wartime propaganda versus this very specific type of, if you want to call it propaganda. Yeah. And that is, during wartime propaganda, you have a very, it's almost easier in a sense that there's your enemy.
Yeah.
You can point to your enemy and you can say, this is why they're different. This is, you know, whether it's Nazism or if it's communism or whatever it is. But in this situation, you're actually trying to re-envision democracy itself. And I just think that that's, you know, a big difference, and you almost have to separate even Bush on the aircraft carrier, because, you know, that was in a time when, you know, he's trying to rile up support for a war. I just don't think it really it goes together so much with this era.
Yeah, I think you're absolutely right. War is both easy and also sort of plays to our worst instincts, because it is just about, we've got to think of ourselves as a we. And the easiest way to do that is have them think of it as a them. Now, one could have imagined a similar moment, and certainly this is what Hitler did, certainly it's what Mussolini did, certainly it's what, you know, Stalin did and Lenin did. He could have gone after the bankers. There could have been lots of propaganda about rich people lounging around in Palm Beach and so on and so forth, while other people, and there are pictures of that. There's actually are pictures from the FSA files. And I don't know how they sent someone there, but sent someone to like a resort in Palm Springs, where you have a bunch of wealthy people. And as far as I know, they were never used. And I think because it was this idea you talked about of like, we are going to talk about a democratic nation, and almost unspoken in almost all of the propaganda, some of it in the murals, but not much, some of it in the theater projects, but not much, is this notion of, if we just imagine there are no wealthy people, we can rethink this country as a country where we're all in this together. Also, FDR was, you know, one of the wealthy people. So there was a kind of vested interest in not...
And there's a limit to, I mean, he talks about that, as you said, that speech, and you know, I invite their hatred, and there definitely is a sense that he says, bring it on. You want to fight? I'm ready to fight. You know, and he doesn't go beyond that.
Right.
And both of his first two inaugural addresses, he talks about the money changers at Wall Street and such. But there's also the question of how successful that would be.
Yeah.
I always love the line from John Steinbeck saying that Americans are just temporarily embarrassed millionaires. And so all those people in the bread lines are, and that's still us, right?
Yeah.
And when Occupy Wall Street, which you know all too well, you know, I was shocked, right, by how that entered the public consciousness, and the whole 1% has become a staple of our framework for understanding. Talk about changing what's sensible, and to my mind, to the good. And I just saw some little thing about Chris Christie trying to say, I'm a regular guy. We only make $700,000 a year. That's not a lot of money to live on. And I don't feel rich.
Oh, that's Hillary Clinton's famous, we're dead broke. She said, we're dead broke. And, you know, they made
$235 million.
Yeah, that was about 8 months ago or something like that. I mean, it's the same sort of thing. Relative to their friends, perhaps they are, but, you know.
I have a sister who lives in Greenwich, Connecticut, but since she's surrounded by billionaires, she's just folk. You know, and in that community, she is. They got a humble little house and stuff, but compared to her college professor brother, you know, it's a different. But my point about all of this is, you know, I was amazed that it got traction and hasn't disappeared completely, although I think that's really still up in the air, this whole class resentment and stuff.
Yeah.
But it'll be interesting in the 30s to see, you know, how much traction that could have had.
Well, I think that part of it had to do with product differentiation, which is the communists had locked up class resentment And the communists were pretty strong at that time. I mean, it's particularly amongst artists and particularly amongst the intellectuals, and also the unions. Until there was the AFL-CIO Accord and the purging of the communists, but that wasn't until after World War II, right? And so the communists had already sort of locked up class resentment, and so the New Deal kind of had to create a different model. And the Republican Party had locked up this sort of nothing's wrong, it will just weather this out and trickle down economics and so on and so forth. So part of it was they had to figure out what terrain was left to them.
But there seems to be a real core sensibility. It's the pragmatist sensibility, yeah. The progressive sensibility that a lot of these people were raised as progressives.
Yeah, yeah.
And so there's actually, and it's funny you use Lippmann, yeah. Because as you well know, in the 20s, his great adversary in the debate about public opinion was John Dewey, yeah. Who has the opposite and is calling for more democracy, yeah. Because the people, you know, in the Jeffersonian way, an educated public can govern itself.
Right?
And I think a lot of these people are much more Deweyan than they are like Lippmann in
yeah.
terms of their ideals of what they're doing.
Although I would argue the brilliance of it is that they actually combine Lippmann and Dewey, is they combine Lippmann's understanding that one has to have, as I said, the will, the beliefs, and the fantasies of people. Yet at the same time, they connect with it that doesn't mean that we have to do away with the democratic discussion that Dewey was talking about. Because the problem with Dewey is everything's great if it's a New England town meeting. But how do you scale it up to a national? And that's really what Lippmann's talking about. That's fine, Dewey, but it doesn't scale. And I think that because this is a national program, they have to figure out how they scale. And part of it is hitting all of these avenues at once.
These guys are usually, you can't shut them up.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Am I intimidating? I don't think of myself
as intimidating. From New York City, right? All the way.
That big intimidation factor.
Now, why don't we talk about some of the ways maybe this impacts your particular projects, right? Does this change the way you're thinking about your projects? Anybody care to share what you're working on, whether it directly relates or not? And we can bring some of that in, see what he has to say about. Go ahead, Dan.
Like I mentioned before, my project is dealing with radio research, and I actually did a lot of research on the fireside chats themselves, that whole concept of, you know, as you mentioned, the idea that this message is being broadcast into the living rooms of the people. And, you know, I got into a little bit about how FDR, we always forget about his situation,
yeah.
Where he actually, they used radio because he had the polio, and they purposely staged him a certain way. And I was reading a lot of research about the way that he spoke to people, and it was interesting, even listening to your clip, I thought it was very effective the way he spoke, because he was actually talking to the people in a way that it wasn't highbrow. He
yeah.
wasn't trying to go above their heads, but even you could just tell in his demeanor, he's like, come along with me.
Yeah.
He wasn't
yeah.
dumbing it down either.
Yeah.
Right. It's actually a great primer on banking if you ever get
right. I learned.
But I think that really played a big part of trying to get at, you know, the idea of the audience, what's being broadcast.
Yeah. Well, and I think that you probably come across this as sort of like what the audience was listening to an hour before and an hour after. And how, and I don't know enough about 1930s radio. What are they listening to like an hour before, an hour after?
Well, there's a really big, a lot of the research goes into the idea and the concept of serious listening.
Mm-hmm.
Who was actually doing serious listening in their home? More often than not, I think, if you look at the numbers in the early 30s especially, it's about 50-60% music. You get a little bit of news in there, but then you start getting like the serial programming
yep.
mixed in, the soaps and stuff like that. But a lot of people tuned in to listen to music. I think when FDR comes along and starts doing the fireside chats and you start getting some of these other talking heads that go on the radio, then it changes a little bit.
And then you get Father Coughlin.
You get Father Coughlin.
Yep.
Figures,
right?
Yeah. Do you run across any, I mean, you have the radio research, which is much of it sort of pure sociological research. You have the market research, which is underwritten by sponsors, right? Do you run across any government research, any government agencies trying to do research to see how their message is getting across?
Off the top of my head, I can't. It comes to mind. I think that they were trying to understand how the how that political message was reaching the people. As far as the methodology for that, I'm not quite certain. I didn't go that far into that direction as far as just the fireside chats. Mm-hmm. But I know that I did start to scratch the surface on that. But they were trying to, they actually hired the Office of Radio Research to also look into those type of things as well. Whether it was political, like you said, their main focus for doing their research, which was at a Columbia University, eventually started in Princeton, mm-hmm. Was to get at that idea of the businessman, then the sponsor. They're trying to see like who was doing serious listening, and one of the bigger researches was to understand the difference between at that time everything that was portrayed to people in a serious way was the written word through books, and how did radio actually change that? Did it change it? How effective was it as compared to a book?
Is this Laswell is doing this?
Lazerfeld, yeah.
Lazerfeld.
And a couple others. That's the Office of Radio Research. Yeah. And then it carried on. Like I said, Columbia University expanded it further.
But have you come across, because now I want to know, did they do any work around the impact of fireside chats?
You know, I'd have to double check on that.
Well, double check and send me anything you come up with.
Okay. I know they checked the, one of their big things was the War of the Worlds broadcast.
Yes. Yeah, exactly.
They did, they wanted to understand how people responded to that from a psychological perspective.
Yeah.
Which was pretty interesting.
Going back to the war, it's so interesting how that changes, right? Mm-hmm. And I suppose it kind of has to. I'm trying to think of an alternative. In the First World War, there was an Office of Propaganda,
yep.
right? But it was centralized, but it was, since the technology didn't exist as well, there wasn't radio. So they had the scripts written in Washington, but the local Chamber of Commerce, citizens would deliver the talks before the movement.
The Minutemen, Five Minutemen? What were the
Four Minutemen, they were called. And then they'd do the Liberty Bond drives and such. And you'd think that on first blush that, you know, Pearl Harbor was propaganda enough, right, to rally the American people. But of course, you know, just as I mentioned, in a dictatorship, the people still do need to be persuaded, if nothing else, to just go along, right? And there's a lot of effort, Nazi Germany, from architecture on up, there's a ton of effort into that. Yeah. And, you know, the cult of personality of Stalin and all of this. So, you know, it is interesting to imagine, could it have been done differently? Mm-hmm. But essentially the New Deal gets, you know, it in itself gets, I'm trying to think of a sort of neutral word, not co-opted or hijacked.
But kind of submerged.
Submerged and merged into, as you say, the sort of the government, the state, corporate, and labor agreement.
Yeah.
Not always to the advantage of labor, but full employment, certainly, if not the right to strike. Right. And it's kind of amazing in my reading of it how it too works, you know, for its purposes. And of course, it's not necessarily an ideal state of society, but how pretty well efficient and it was a command economy, but not a totalitarian system.
Well, and you know, propaganda-wise, the Office of War Information takes over all this. And the Office of War Information really gobbles up the FSA, the RA. But it's still run by a poet, Archibald MacLeish. You know, I remember from writing about a cockroach, you know? So it's this fascinating idea of like a poet running the propaganda agency. And the propaganda was probably more nuanced than the picture I put up there. Really sort of almost avant-garde displays in Grand Central Station of it's like a collage of soldiers and military. It almost looks like Russian constructivism. I mean, aesthetically, it's very sophisticated, but what drops out is the individuals. You just don't see them anymore. You don't hear them anymore because, as you pointed out, you can't go to war thinking about individuals. It just doesn't work.
Betty Grable. That is, you're going to fight for the woman back home and the starlet with the legs. I mean, there's that system continues
She's kind of an object.
Yeah, but it's still the representation of, you know, sexual desire, but also of mom, sister, girlfriend, wife, all of these things.
And what's interesting is what does happen to the FSA and RA photos and WPA photos as they go into war is they become what we're fighting for. And so lots of pictures of wheat fields, lots of pictures of family farms, and also the industrial power of the state. So lots of pictures of factories, assembly lines, and hydroelectric dams. But the individual worker people kind of drop out, and it becomes much more an abstraction.
And they become types.
Yeah, they become there.
And I think that was really important, what you were saying here, and I don't know that I'd ever quite made that. You know, in a sense, she is represented, but she's before she's representative, she is an individual.
Exactly.
It's what makes it work as art and maybe as propaganda.
Yeah.
Something just came to mind. We were talking a bit about, you had said that you thought FDR's fireside chats through the medium of radio was the most successful way to spread this message. And the interesting thing that that I've run across is the concept that you're speaking about individuals. And what I found so interesting about looking at 1930s radios, in the 20s when radio started, it started as very much so a hobbyist type of thing. People were doing it in their basement. But then even when it started getting into the programming, it started to expand to a more localized, you would say even like a town hall debate, because it was dealing very much so with the local area. And then the more that it grew and the more that it went national and you had these sponsors and things like that, then you started to get a message coming across that was very much produced, very much thought out in a way to whether it was to sell the programming itself or whether it was to sell something that the advertisers wanted. And what's interesting about that is the idea that in itself happening and coinciding with FDR beginning his fireside chats would almost make that message more palatable to people, because they're already used to getting this kind of refined and thought out kind of conceived message.
Yeah, I actually think you're absolutely right. I don't think it would have been possible without national networks, not just and it's a bill. Oh, it doesn't. Sometimes it has the national networks up on the radio mics on the photos. But I like what you're saying, which is the idea of a unified national voice. That's actually very helpful. That we're used to now thinking of Nabisco, right? In the voice of Nabisco or the Fireside Theater or whatever those things were called. Was it Fireside Theater? Yeah. And we're used to that national voice, and so when FDR comes on as a national voice, it's not out of the ordinary. It's good.
Like there's maybe, you know, there's a decade or so of that, and there's a whole lot of, in the 20s, there is a whole lot of intellectual and artists' attention to what is American media, you know, and so, and I think that's been going on forever, but a sense, and I think you're right, that it's the networks, radio, but also roads, and just the industrial infrastructure and the war, really. Yeah. The First World War really creates that national consciousness in a way. And first time many, many people, millions of people, have left their borough, right? Have left their valley. And so it sort of does build on that. But it's always in tension with local often. And I liked your, you know, the propaganda of the material, right? Talk about the propaganda of the deed, the TVA, right? Yeah. Democratizes electricity. Yeah. And, you know, you mentioned Obama, and I happen to agree that, you know, his whole smartest man in the room who forgets to kind of bring the rest of us along thing really doesn't serve him and has been a great source of frustration to me. And I'm not certain, I think I've talked about this before, I'm not certain, but I had a fantasy that he was facing a March 1933 moment when he was inaugurated and could have used the moment to, like FDR, say, basically, you're coming along for the ride or we're going to make it happen without you.
Well, which he's done in the past year and a half.
Which he's done in the
right.
last, but,
well,
you know,
past
and,
half
but
year.
His ability to get things done is severely diminished. But the use of, you know, the bully pulpit, as they call it, and again, the infrastructure, we still know FDR because there's a road named after him, but not just named after, because it was built under his administration. Half of the
bridges.
Of his area was built during that period.
Yeah.
And, you know, I remember when the stimulus package did go through, driving through, you know, this, it's kind of this traffic jam brought to you by Obama with the construction, but, you know, in the long run, this road, this, you know, 10-lane highway, you know, you could have a reputation for generations if you do it right, which I don't think they did.
Yeah.
The administration did.
Yeah, I agree.
And again, I'm not certain that they actually really had the ability to do so.
Yeah, I'm not certain, but I also don't think they thought in that way. I think we could talk about the faults of the Obama administration, but for days, and we should, actually, in a lot of ways. Partially, I think that they really believed in sort of a compromise government, right, and that they didn't need to explain things, that Rahm Emanuel was all about making deals, and the Democrats are no longer the party of machine politics and immigrants, and are the politics of a liberal elite. I think the Republicans are right about that. And the liberal elite doesn't need to explain themselves to people. So I think that there's so much that went into, it's no accident that I think Obama has not used the bully pulpit, not used propaganda, except when he was getting elected, and he's very good at it then.
Right, right.
So he has the skills, right, and he has the team that can do it.
You know, not the sensibility, and those weren't the issues. I think that's really clear. And in fact, I've always said, when the parties agree, I mean, he wasn't paying attention to what the Republicans were explicitly saying, that our goal is to not allow him to achieve anything,
right?
And that had already been building even before Obama, but wasn't paying attention. But as to, you know, as what's going on now, my philosophy is always, when the parties do agree is when you really need to get scared, you know, because that's when they're really not looking out for us.
Right.
So compromise and agreement, bipartisanship is the more dangerous thing from my perspective. And they all agree on war, endlessly and everywhere. And that's true.
That's true.
Well, I think we've, you know, yeah, go ahead.
Do you think that this Democratic propaganda expanded to, say, movies and the cartoons that came with the movies?
The thing is the government did not control Hollywood or any of the sort of cartoons or anything. They produced some movies, like some of the movies coming out of the FSA. WPA produced really bad movies. But the things like cartoons and sort of Hollywood movies were produced essentially out of Hollywood, sometimes sympathetic. But they were working on a very different principle, which was, how do we create the biggest audience in order to get many people into the theater? Insofar as capitalism has to be democratic in thinking of us as a consumer base, yes. That is, it has to be able to appeal to a mass amount of people as consumers. But it only thinks of us as consumers. It doesn't think of us as citizens.
Do you see in, you know, not something like Pere Lorentz, but a sort of New Deal sensibility in someone like Capra?
Yeah. Well, that's partly because, one, Capra himself had some of those politics. But it also had to do with this idea, we talked about the redistribution of the sensible, is that the New Deal was so successful, actually, in terms of changing the discourse about what the country was, that then you actually had people like, Capra would have done it anyway, Steinbeck would have written it anyway, but you had big movie moguls greenlighting those projects because they conceived of a mass audience for this sort of stuff because it resonated with FDR's. You know, capitalism is just opportunistic. That is, it is only interested in making money. And if it can make money by selling New Deal politics, then it will make money selling New Deal politics. Fox is the perfect example of this. Its news is very conservative. Its entertainment is the most subversive entertainment that's on. Why? And how do you make sense of those two things? They're owned by the same person. Is both make lots of money. So there you go.
All right. Well, thank you very much.
Well, thank you for having me.